the Black Sprayhood podcast. We'd like to welcome you to our very first episode with Henning Glabbart, who is a visual effects artist and supervisor, and he worked on the film Adrift. We will be talking about the film, so if you haven't seen it yet, go and watch it first. We filmed this during the second London lockdown, before Luciano and I and the cats took off on our sailing adventure, so most of the footage was filmed in London.
Welcome to the Black Sprayhood podcast. Welcome, Henning Glabbart. Thanks for being so brave, accepting our invitation. You are officially our first guest.
Hi, well, thanks for having me. Excited to be here, see what happens.
Oh, cool. I have checked like some of your work online. You have worked as a visual effects artist and supervisor on some great movies. Within the films that you worked on, I found a VFX Oscar winner, blockbusters, streaming hits, etc. There was one film in particular that caught my attention. It's a drama based on like a real story about love and endurance, and it has sailboats on it. The film is called Adrift. Before telling us about what you actually had done on this particular film, could you quickly explain to us the difference between visual effects and special effects, and what made you choose this career?
The differences get a bit more blurry these days, but generally when you talk about visual effects, you are talking about things that kind of get done after the fact, that get done digitally in the computer. So like replacing backgrounds, adding things like, I don't know, creatures, or adding destruction to buildings or scenes or something like that. Whereas special effects is generally stuff that's done on set already. So you have people who kind of like fire real explosions that then get like caught in camera. Or I don't know, you have people with like smoke machines or those kind of things. So everything that actually gets kind of like effects-y, but it gets caught in camera already, that's considered special effects. And like visual effects, that's what we do, is kind of like mostly computer-based and done after the general shoot.
That actually really helped me understand it. So what kind of visual effects did you and your team do on Adrift?
Well, we did a lot of effects-y work. So we did a lot of the oceans. So the film kind of like follows this couple on the boat who kind of like end up in this massive storm in the Pacific. And yeah, obviously things like that are very hard to shoot in real life. So, they've come to us for help and to, yeah, kind of like create a massive storm digitally. So they had the boat, like a real boat, kind of on like a hydraulic stage. So they had some actual movement of the boat so that when the actors were on the boat, they would actually kind of like lose the balance a little bit and stuff like that. But, and they had some water shoots as well. So there you go, special effects on set.
Where
they had actual water kind of like splashing the actors and stuff like that. But all the backgrounds, like obviously there was no water around it. There was like a big massive green screen around the boat. And then it was our job to kind of make up the ocean surface around it and kind of create a massive simulation of a stormy ocean with stormy skies and all that, and make it look like the boat was actually moving forward in the waves and kind of match the movement that they've done on set so that it matched our ocean surface and all that. And on top of that, kind of like do a bit of a choreography of the waves, because you know, there's a few scenes in there where, you know, there's certain waves kind of like trigger certain events in the movie, or in particular one massive wave does. So yeah, we had to kind of like choreograph how waves crash against the boat to kind of match with the stuff they did on set, and all those kind of things kind of like to blur kind of like the so you wouldn't see where the CG water or the computer water starts and where the actual water stops, or vice versa. So yeah, that was what we did.
So when you're having to do visual effects of the type that you've never done before, so where you've got like massive crashing waves in a stormy sea. How do you prepare for that if you've never worked on those kinds of special effects before? Like, do you have to go and observe breaking waves, or how do you do it?
Yeah, so we did look at a lot of footage. So luckily these days with YouTube, you have like a wealth of reference online. So a lot of times like big ocean liners, they kind of have cameras on the bridge, and you can kind of see what happens in a massive storm and how much the boat actually, how much the boat moves, even a giant kind of like ocean cruiser, and also what happens on the ocean surface when those waves crash, how the white water looks, how the little crests on the wave look and all that. And then you try as best as you can to kind of replicate that look in the computer. And yeah, you spend long hours in dark rooms staring at a screen, crossing your fingers that this simulation is going to come out looking right.
Well, I'm guessing that's still better than being in a real storm.
Yeah, absolutely. But it was still, I mean, you wouldn't really know by looking at the final result, but the creation of the movie was actually quite traumatic, because like we did have to work a lot of long hours, and you know, we're always kind of like always chasing deadlines, and it was a very tough project to finish, like you said, because we'd never actually done like massive ocean simulations before. So it was kind of like, you know, literally like new waters for us. And so yeah, we struggled a bit to kind of like get to where the client was finally saying, okay, like I'm happy with this. And it was tough.
And then like for a project like this, like did you have to learn anything about sailing for this project? And have you had like any director's notes or written feedback that had like sailing terminology on it that you were like, oh, what are these guys talking about?
Well, I mean, unfortunately, it wasn't like a team building exercise where we all went out on a weekend to like go on a boat or anything. But I mean, for me, obviously, like in my role as a compositor, I'm kind of like at the very end of the pipeline. So like I kind of get all the assets that the 3D people are building, all the simulations from effects, all the lightings from the render guys. And I just put it all together. So for me, it's more about the look of everything. But I'm sure like the people we had to do a model of the boat. So, and you know, it had to be a specific boat. Like we had like an actual, obviously, like, as you said, it's based on a real story. So there was a real boat, and we tried to kind of like model it and replicate it as closely as possible. They rebuilt kind of like a model on set as well, so we had to match that pretty closely. So obviously, like people who do modeling and that kind of stuff, so they obviously have to really dig deep and get into boat terminology. And I think the director was a sailor, like he knew how to sail, so he obviously, gave some just very specific feedback on like, okay, yeah, no, the sails, they don't do that in wind. Like, you know, you wouldn't see that. Like the frequency of the movement in the sails would be much higher, or I don't know, or you would have to know which one is, what is it? Luff and lee? No. Like right and left on the boat, what is it called?
Port and starboard. Well, starboard and port.
Yeah, exactly. So you didn't have to know that, because he'd give you feedback like, oh yeah, no, we need to lean more starboard. And it's like, which side is that? And, but yeah, that kind of stuff. So yeah, he would throw around like some, even like bits of the boat, you know, like you would know which mast he's talking about, or that kind of stuff. So you would kind of like have to know a little bit about boat sailing terminology.
Cool. And then when you actually have the like opportunity to go on holiday, can you easily like switch off from work, or you are one of those guys that are like constantly photographing and filming everything in case you need like a visual reference for a future project?
I don't really do that. I mean, I look at things differently, I think, you know, sometimes like I think I should take a picture of this, or I wish I had like a good camera now so I could use this like as an element for later. I think I like observe differently than I did before I started working in visual effects, just to, yeah, I don't know, just staring at clouds and like see how they move, or how the light reacts in there, like when the sun moves, or when the wind is strong or whatever. But yeah, I don't really take a lot of reference footage when I'm on holiday. I try to switch off if I can.
Yeah, that's good. That's very, very wise. There's another thing as well, like I notice quite a lot these days, there's a lot of cosmetic work in visual effects. I know, like an artist, for example, they had to clean out some showing genitals on a fighting scene for a famous film. There's also like a recent story about like artists had to like remove like Henry Cavill's mustache on a reshoot for Superman or something like that. What was the funniest thing that you have been asked to do like using your skills?
The funniest. Good question. I don't know. I mean, I don't know if it's actually funny, but like we did a lot of work for Doctor Who. And so like, I mean, the premises of Doctor Who are often pretty ridiculous, you know? So, I mean, you do end up laughing a lot at your screen because it's just so ridiculous what's happening. But, you know, that's just the nature of the show. It's just kind of like silly and fun. But I can't really think of any like specific example where I'm like, okay, this is ridiculous. Like, what am I doing here? Yeah, I don't know. We'll have to think about that.
Cool. We can go back to that.
So how has the pandemic changed the demand for your work? Obviously, there's been a lot more people staying at home, watching TV. Has there been an increase in demand, or has the kind of restrictions on filming actually led to a slowdown?
Well, for us, it has meant a bit of a slowdown. I think in general, of course, yeah, like I think the big streaming companies are very eager to like create more more content and like to start filming again. I mean, I know a lot of people are very busy again now. We were lucky enough at the beginning of lockdown that we had like just finished filming for a big project that we were going to work on. So we were actually set for most of the year. We had our work laid out for us. We didn't really have to worry about that at that point. But yeah, as the year came to a close and we finished the project, then like we really kind of went into a hole and we didn't have anything to do. It's kind of slowly picking up now that like people are starting to film again. But there was a period of a few months where I think our producers were bidding on like literally hundreds of shows, but it was all up in the air because no one could shoot anything. So I think. Yeah, I know other people are busy again, but yeah, I don't know. For us at the moment, it's very quiet, and like it's not going to start picking up until later in the year, I think.
Cool. And then, where do you prefer working? Do you like work from home, or do you prefer work in the office?
Well, it's difficult. I mean, I don't mind working from home. I like. In theory, having the option to work from home, but like this, like mandatory working from home is kind of like eating at me. You know, like visual effects is a very collaborative business, so you do have to talk to your colleagues and like to people from different departments all the time, and it makes it so much easier if you can just walk over to someone's desk and talk to them about it, or just just tap someone on the shoulder and like get a few people in the room for a meeting rather than. Doing it like this. So I think, yeah, I'm eager to get back into the office once we are allowed to. Mind you, right now we don't even have an office anymore to save some money. They didn't sign, renew the lease. And at the moment we're all working from home. And while they are looking for a new office, so they don't want to keep us at home at all times. But at the moment, while we're pretty quiet, you know, only have like a few small projects that we're working on. So I figured it's a good way to save some money and look for something maybe a bit smaller and cheaper in the long run. But yeah, I think in terms of preference, I think I would like to have the option to work at home. Like I very much like the idea of not having like dinner delivered to my desk in the office because I have to wait for 3D renders because I have to deliver something in the morning. I'd much rather just go home, have like a normal dinner, and then when the render is actually ready, I get like a little message and I can do it real quickly. But yeah, and you know, working from home like a day or two per week, it's great as well. But I think on a whole, I prefer kind of like the face-to-face work in the office.
Cool. Yeah, you mentioned it like about rendering. So basically, this is when like you finish your work and then you send your work and then the computer has to basically compact those images. What is actually rendering?
Yeah, rendering. Well, I mean, in terms of like doing 3D work, you know, obviously 3D artists, they kind of like build their models and or creatures or whatever in the computer. So you have like a 3D model in the computer. And then people kind of like simulate certain lighting conditions. They determine what each surface of the object or models should look like. And then ideally the computer will turn that into an image that you can then look at. And this process of turning a computer model that has been kind of like defined with certain lighting conditions, certain surface properties and certain, I don't know, animations and stuff like that, to turn that into an image sequence, that is called rendering. So the computer then turns the model that is like, I don't know, sometimes several gigabytes big per frame, and they just turn that into just a regular image, like a JPEG or an EXR. It's what we work with usually.
I guess it takes a lot of computers and a lot of hours to render like an entire movie. One single shot can surpass hundreds of versions until its final version. Following the controversy of cryptocurrency, where allegedly it's really bad for the environment because of its mining, I tried to find out if Henning knew how bad rendering could be for the environment.
To be honest, I've not really looked into it. So, I mean, obviously, yeah, like those kind of like high-powered computers, they do tend to like eat a lot of energy. And then on top of that, you have to kind of like cool all those data centers down because like computers generate a lot of heat. So yeah, I guess it's not great for the environment versus not doing it. But I'm not sure if it's like compared to other industries, if it's like a massive impact, to be honest.
Fair enough.
Like I think probably, you know, a Google search is probably just as or even more environmentally damaging as like rendering an image, I would say.
So I'm amazed to see the evolution in visual effects in the last few decades. We've already got the introduction of artificial intelligence and machine learning tools to the visual effects pipeline. And artists obviously are really hard workers. They have to deal with really tight deadlines and a lot of overtime, plus all the lack of social events in lockdown. Obviously, it can take a toll on mental health. So how do you keep healthy and what have you been doing to cheer up yourself and the team?
How do I keep healthy? Well, I mean, like you guys, I'm vegan. So I think that, you know, a healthy diet is pretty important. So again, since I'm at home all the time, we're cooking way more. So no more takeaway food, no more late night kind of like greasy burgers at the office and stuff like that. I don't know. I've been going on a lot of walks because it's like pretty much the only thing you can do really. I'm often too lazy to go for a run. Don't really like it. Every once in a while I kind of like force myself, but yeah, like I would say my daily walks have been, yeah, they've helped a lot to both kind of get my ass moving a little bit and to change the scenery a little bit. Like we're lucky enough to live in an area that has a lot of green around it, so I just, yeah, basically step outside my door and there's like a massive park, and yeah, we have like the River Lee that goes here, so you can walk along the towpath and stuff like that. So been doing that. Started doing yoga at home. I feel like the bar is kind of like low enough. It's not really exercise, but it's still kind of like, you know, it makes you feel good about yourself, and it's a bit of like the stretching kind of like reminds me a little bit of martial arts. Like I used to do Muay Thai before everything closed down. So this is a little bit kind of like the warm up for Muay Thai. So it keeps me flexible and It also helps after like sitting or standing at your desk for hours on end to kind of, to get moving a little bit.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah, that's it.
You mentioned being a vegan there, and obviously I'm guessing part of that is caring about animals. Do you think that CGI creatures are actually saving the real animals from exploitation by the film industry, or do real animals have to pose for the animators?
I'm sure they still have to pose, they make them kind of run through whatever, like motion capture stages and stuff like that. But at least they don't have to, like, they don't send horses in like really dangerous situations anymore, for example, or make them or teach them how to kind of fall down or whatever, which could potentially be dangerous for them. So, I think in a way it does make the animal's life a bit easier if you can, if you can just shoot a digital horse and make it fall over, that makes it easier for real life animals. But as you said, for animation purposes, they still may have to pose. I've seen stuff for Planet of the Apes, for example, they set up a massive mocap stage, so motion control or motion capture, to kind of transfer the motion of the real horse into the computer and kind of capture how the horse moves and to use that for their own simulations. But I guess it's just kind of like a horse running from A to B. It's not really harmed in the process. And on top of that, there's so much video footage out there online now that to study animals, there's just a wealth of footage out there that you don't really have to, catch or make a real animal do the things that you want them to do.
That's very good to hear.
That's cool, yeah. Actually, we saw like the evolution of like visual effects, and then I guess like nowadays we can't tell the difference between CG and real. The CG animals have improved a lot. I have seen like a lot of cool like CG humans on independent shots, but nothing that can be consistent along like an entire sequence. I know that you are a 2D artist, but can you point out what is makes so hard to actually treat like human eye, and then when it comes to like CG humans?
Well, I think the problem is that we as humans were so tuned into little movements in the face, humans kind of like, they express their emotions through their face and like everything. And, sometimes it's just like very, very little movements, like tiny twitches or, little eye movements or things like that. So I think getting all that getting a computer model to do all that, I think it's tricky, to make it convincing. I don't know what exactly it is, but I think it's just that we as humans are so used to looking at human faces, and subconsciously everyone knows what a human face looks like and how it moves, and if it's just a tiny bit off, like people will notice, like and I think that's the problem, to just kind of like really nail that those little tiny details 100%. I think it's still kind of tricky.
I don't know, maybe it's a good thing that we can't be completely fooled.
with deepfakes now, sometimes you almost can tell, I don't know if you've seen like Tom Cruise ones. I've seen the befores and afters. I mean, the guy who did the actual video, who like posed as Tom Cruise, I mean, he looks a lot like him, like the hair, they used his hair. And they just kind of, his face looks a little bit like Tom Cruise. Like with a little bit of magic of like AI and all that, they just like turned his face into Tom Cruise. And I couldn't tell. Like that one looks 100% real to me. Like I would have believed it was Tom Cruise. Like I didn't believe it was a deep fake when I first saw it, but it is. And it's like, that is kind of scary. Yeah.
Yeah. So, more of a light-hearted question at the end. So you mentioned earlier that working in visual effects has changed the way that you see the world in a lot of ways. What about when you are watching films? Are you able just to relax and watch the film? Or are you, like somebody else I know, are you watching the film as a VFX critic?
It depends. If it's well done visual effects, sometimes I subconsciously think, okay, yeah, that's well done. But you know, if it doesn't take me out of the story, then I can enjoy the film. If it's badly done, it takes me out, because then, like, I notice something. It's like, oh, why didn't they fix that? Or like, you know, it's like it's such a quick thing to fix. Or so it depends. I think, yeah, if it's a good film, where I enjoy the story and like I'm captured by the story, I tend to forget about it unless it's bad visual effects. I don't know. And if it's not a good film or series, whatever, I'm a bit bored, then my eyes may start wandering and I start analyzing stuff. But I would say I can switch off the VFX critic and I can enjoy a film.
That's good. So I think like we have like already like our last question. So are you allowed to listen to music or our podcast in working hours? And then actually, if yes, what kind of music inspire you?
It depends. When I'm working as a supervisor, obviously, you know, I have to sit in dailies a lot, which means like I sit with other supervisors and producers in a screening room, and I look at other people's work, and I have to kind of like comment on it or give feedback. So obviously I can't sit there with my headphones on, but if I'm working on shots myself, sitting at my desk, absolutely, I can, and I do listen to music or podcasts or stuff like that. I am a big fan of like post rock, post metal, anything post really. I guess it lends itself to kind of like listen to in the background a little bit, because it tends to be kind of very cinematic. You know, it has often doesn't have any vocals in it, so it's just, and it's can be kind of like very repetitive and. It kind of swells and ebbs a little bit. So, post-rock for me is kind of like ideal music to work to and just like to have in the background and to chill while I'm working.
Oh, cool. And then if you could pick like a song and a film that marks like this last year for you, what would that be?
Ooh. Good question. I'm not sure if I've seen any films last year. Mostly seen like just like some sort of series and just like stupid crap on Netflix. I don't know. In terms of songs, I don't know. I've listened, which is actually not really post-rock. It's more kind of like progressive metal. But I've listened to an album by a band called Unprocessed. They're a German band. This crazy progressive metal, and for me, who, you know, someone who plays guitar and kind of like enjoys and appreciates good guitar playing, it's just amazing what the guys are doing. And forget what the album is actually called, but yeah, the latest album by Unprocessed, that's been my top album of the last year probably. In terms of film, I don't know. It's all a blur. I couldn't tell you right now.
I don't think I could answer that question either.
Well, be like Contagious, something like that.
Yeah, I didn't watch any of those. I did look forward to watching Tenet. I ended up not watching it, so that's still on my list. I have a feeling that is something that I will enjoy, because I generally like Christopher Nolan films. So.
Yeah, that was actually the only film that we managed to watch last year between lockdowns, on the cinema.
Oh, okay. Well done. Yeah, no, I haven't been to the cinema in over a year. Sad times.
Henny, thank you very much for your time. It has been incredible talking to you.
Yeah, thank you for having me. good luck with the podcast. I hope we didn't ruin it just in the beginning. So good luck with it.
No, I actually learned a lot and it's really interesting. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks for making it all the way to the end. If you'd like to find out more about our sailing adventures, please find out on theblacksprayhood.com.